conference call in. Can we start? Okay, sure. Oh. A very good afternoon to everybody. Let's start the discussion for today. So we are going to discuss today about trade databases, the data extraction and analysis for export decision making. Ideally, when we try to export and import, then the main concern for us would be how to select the market. And for that purpose, we need to use a couple of databases. So in this particular discussion, we are going to spend about a couple of minutes on how can you extract the data from various international trade databases. And we are going to apply a couple of them in real time. I will request some of you to go for some of the product code. If you are already exporting some, you can suggest to me which one can be useful. And any queries you have in mind, we can look into that at the end of the session. So for about up to 7:30, we can continue the discussion. And after that, we can go for the discussion of the doubts, etc. I'll speak in the first 10-15 minutes on trade data classification system. Those of you who are already aware of that, for them it will be a brush up. And for those who are currently in the process of entering the export business, it can be an interesting idea. So let me proceed one by one. Usually, when we are going to go for international trade, we are going to go for something called international trade data. The classification of international trade data will be by harmonized system. Why the name harmonized system? The answer is pretty clear. Suppose you are trying to export a product, say a 100% cotton shirt to another country. However, at the time of entry, the customs official might be a bit confused. Suppose they have a 5% duty on 100% cotton shirt and a 7% duty on shirts which are made of, let's say, 40% cotton and 60% terricot or terry wool or some other form of fiber. How can they understand whether you are exporting 100% cotton shirt? The idea is now harmonized system. World Customs Organization has selected, made a classification by which once the Indian exporter is using a particular code, every country, customs officials of every country, they understand it's the 100% cotton shirt or a particular product the exporter is talking about. For instance, we are looking at some of the automobiles. So if you write a particular code, it will be very clear to the importing country official that it's a 1000cc engine vehicle or a 3000cc engine vehicle. There will be different codes for each product. I will just look into the classification system very quickly for about 10 minutes. Then we can go for the market selection. Harmonized system, as the system we talked about, it goes with a very clear linear selection process. There are 21 sections, 99 chapters, 1243 headings, and more than 5000 subheadings. As you can see, over the period, the classification has changed. In fact, every 5 years, the harmonized system classification changes. The section, chapter, or heading, they never change. The change, any change that takes place is in the lower level of classification only. Why change in classification every 5 years? Well, the answer is very clear. Some of the products like dot matrix printer, it becomes dated and it will no longer be traded. So in an old ages classification of 1988 or 96, dot matrix printer was being traded very heavily. But there was no new product that we see today, for instance, iPhone or the laptop charger batteries, laptop charger power banks. So for these new products, in classification of 2017, new product codes must come. That's the reason why we see the classification changing very regularly. Just in case you are trying to look for a particular product, how can you know which product, which code will be assigned to your product? Stated alternatively, if you are, let's say, trying to import a product, or you are trying to export a product, and you are talking with one of the possible trade partner in another country, and they are asking for a product, how can you know which is the product code for your product? You can follow the harmonized system classification. For instance, we can look at the HS 2, 4 or 6 digit in the following manner. Say, we can talk about a common product, leather bag. Now, HS code 42, well, that's the HS 2 digit. 2 digit code or chapter, we can get the leather products will come under HS 42. Now, we have to go for the bags. So within HS code 42, we are going to have 4201, 4202, 4203, various codes. The handbags, etc., will come under 4202. Now within 420, we are going to have the classification at the next level, at 6-digit level. So 420221, we might find the description will match the bag, the handbag that maybe your trade partner is asking for. And you can actually go further down at HS 8 digit level, which are called the tariff line or product line. Similarly, for another product, leather wallet, if we try to think of that again, we can try to think of similar classification. First, you understand what product it is that we are going to get from HS 2 digit level classification, a leather product. So coming under HS 42, we are going to then look for where the wallets would come. You will find it in 4202, but the HS 6 digit code is going to change. If we go back for a second, 420221, we found the handbags of leather. Now 420232, we are going to find the wallet, purse and other products are coming here. So now what we need to find is how the classification under HS is going to take place, and then we can go towards finding how the we can use some of the trade databases for our advantage. First, as I said, HS chapter will be of 2-digit classification, just like the leather, as we have seen under HS 42. So if we are trying to find the code for a product where you are not aware of the product code, for instance, we are going to find it from two different perspectives. We can, one, try to think of material content. So rubber products will be under HS 40, plastic products will be under HS 39, wood under 44, cotton under 52, iron and steel product would come under 72, likewise. Some of the product, however, would be by usage or function. For instance, HS 28 or 29, they will depict the organic and inorganic chemicals. Now, HS 30 will be the pharmaceutical products. So pharmaceutical products are also chemical products, but for a very specific usage or function. Similarly, under HS 64, we might find footwear. Now, footwears will be either of rubber or of leather. But once they have been made into a particular product, they are going to be very clearly under footwear. Similarly, iron and steel product, we can make motor vehicles in every motor vehicle, there will be the part and made of iron and steel. But once they have been converted into motor vehicle, they will come under HS87 or the auto component. Let's say if we think of the gearbox or the gear rod, that will come not under iron or steel, but come under motor vehicle HS87. Similarly, arms and ammunition, instead of coming under lead, the bullets, they will come under chapter 93. So we will remember it in the following manner. And there is one more system we will remember in mind, the stage of processing. A rule of thumb we are going to follow: less processed product, they will come closer to 1. More processed product, they will come closer to 99. I just take two examples: paper pulp, paper rim, I mean, and books and magazine. If we try to consider, they will appear under 47, 48, and 49 respectively. So you can see more processed product is appearing at a later ages chapter. Or cotton, fiber, fabric, or garments, we will find they will come under ages 52 cotton, fibers under 55, 56, fabrics under 59, 60, and garments under 61, 62. So what you have to do, you have to just think under which section your product, under which chapter your product should fall, and accordingly we will be able to figure out where your product must be falling if you are not aware of exact the product code. I will just take two more minutes to drive the point home. For instance, say you are a bit confused where a product should fall into. I will take two set of examples. Say we think of a couple of automobile products. In an automobile, you are going to have glass, you are going to have plastic, you are going to have lot many products. So you will find, of course, we currently have tubeless tires as well, but if you think of the traditional tubes, we are going to find that there is going to be the inner tube. The inner tube is made of rubber. Here, this can be used in motor car, can be used for some other purpose. So it's being determined by the material content coming under HS40. However, when we think of the safety airbags, which are also made of rubber and a couple of other materials, here the safety airbag is going to be made used only in the automobiles. That is, if your car collide with another vehicle or a wall, then the safety airbag will come out and the driver will not get hurt. It would be a HS87, that is a automobile product. When you are putting the key in your start ignition, then it's essentially an electrical product, HS85, because that ignition you can use in automobile, you can use it in trawler, essentially in several other cases wherever a machinery, a electrical component is involved. So it is not under HS87. And lastly, if we are looking at the fiber made seat covers, the seat covers are going to come under HS63, under the other made up textile articles. One more thing I think I should also note here, say that's the stage of value addition point. If you are supposed to try export granite, which is in the base form, it's not polished, just in the crude or roughly trimmed form that you are exporting, that would come under HS25. But if you have polished the granite and you are trying to sell a more value added product, that is going to come under HS68. So even the same product, and this is an exception product actually, where it is appearing in two very different HS chapters, you have to be very careful. If you are writing a wrong code, your consignment might get rejected by the importing country government. And lastly, one last example, I will just be here for a second and move ahead. So if you are again exporting a sculpture, a statue, a lion made of, let's say, wrought iron, made of lead or bronze or any other metal, once it is a sculpture or work of art, it is going to appear under Aegis 97. But when you are suppose making the talking about the cooking utensils, then it will depend, like Aegis 74, the copper, or the aluminum under Aegis 76 or under 69, when we talk about the glass and other products, they are not, there is no specific kitchen usage Aegis code that we have. Here, everything is determined by the material content. So that's it with the understanding of the Aegis code classification part. I hope the brief discussion is okay with you. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to just move forward a little with the Aegis classification for a couple of product, and I will take 2 minutes on one of the very practical concern with the Aegis code, that is the concern over the comparability of data. So first, let me just briefly scroll over the classification under various product and how you can find your product. So as you understand by now, it will be very easy to identify the Aegis chapter or the 2-digit level of classification. So if you are exporting a copper product, you know the product will be under Aegis 74. If you are exporting an aluminium product, you know it should come under Aegis 76, unless there is a specific usage of the product. Then you have to think under which chapter the product might go. Now, once you go into a chapter, you are going to look into the heading or Aegis 4-digit classification. For instance, under nickel, if it is unwrought nickel, so you are going to select 7502 or so on. Let me take 2 very specific examples, like you are exporting fruit, for instance. In that case, you go to Aegis 08, where the fruit products will be there. Now, you try to select which type of product you want to export. Are you trying to export watermelon? Then you are going to 0807 for getting exactly which code for melon will be utilized. Are you going to export, let's say, lemon or other citrus fruits, orange, let's say? Then you are going to go for Aegis 0805. Essentially here, or if you are going for frozen fruit, dried fruit, you are accordingly going for these products. Now, and similarly for zinc under Aegis 79, for instance, unwrought zinc, a low value added product, will appear under 7901. Zinc waste and scrap or dust, they will appear under 790203, and bar plate or tube will appear at a later point. One more thing, any product for which you are not getting the code, in all probability will appear under NES. What is NES? NES is not elsewhere specified. So products which are being traded, but being traded in a very small form, so there is no specific code given to it, then they all will appear under NES. You have to then look under the NES. So as I said, under citrus fruit, for exporting orange or any other product, or any particular type, let's say grapefruit, you are going to go for 080540, orange you are going for 080510, and so on. So this is how you are going to find the product of your choice. So as a recap, if we just go for another product, the same discussion, like 08, we can go for edible fruit and nut, 0801, the Brazil nuts, and finally, fresh or dried cashew nuts in shell, we can go for the HS6 and finally the 8-digit product. One very important thing we have to now keep in mind. You are exporting one particular product to America, suppose. As I said, that the classification is harmonized system. That means logically, the code that you are using in India should be the same with that in America. Well, there is a limit to that argument. What is the limit to that argument? The limit to the argument is up to HS6 digit, the two countries' codes are harmonized. But below 6 digit, the codes are not harmonized. So you have to understand what can be the code for your product in the other countries. I will take two examples quickly. One, the fresh watermelons. So let's say you are trying to export watermelon to America. You know, 08 edible fruit you should be looking under, 0807 melon you have identified, 080711 would be the fresh watermelons. Now, in India, look at the HS code for HS 8 digit level, 0807 1100. If the last two digits are zero, all of you have seen, if let's say there are two zeros after the decimal point, then the zeros are not counted. It's something like that. If there are two zeros at the end, that means there is a single product under HS 8 digit level. So in India, there is only one classification of the watermelons. Conversely, if you go to US, there are four classifications for watermelon at HS 10 digit level. America go for a very detailed classification. Seedless watermelon, with seed watermelon, seedless watermelon imported during April 1 to November 30, and watermelon imported during December 1 to March 31st. So, depending on exact classification of your product by American definition, you have to put the code for America in your export document. So, you have to understand not only the basic principle of HS, but also how other countries are defining their product at their HS classification at the base level or the maximum disaggregated level of classification very carefully. The watermelon example is my favorite because here we can see how the four different classifications are coming. And one more example, again involving India and America. Here I am not looking at all the classification of America, but logically we can make out. So here, suppose you are trying to export rectangular blocks of stainless steel bar or rod. Now, 72 iron and steel product you identify, semi-finished product 7218 you identify, rectangular cross section 721891 you identify, and then what you find at HS 8 digit level in India, there is a single product 7218 9100. In America, what they are doing, they are going for a very detailed kind of definition. So just read the definition of America. One product selection I am looking at: semi-finished stainless steel rectangular cross section width at least 4 times the thickness. So there is 3 times, 4 times, 5 times. America is defining the product in a very micro detail. So what we find in this example, you have to be very particular about in America exact what definition your product will classify under. Now, let's go for one very important consideration. As you can understand, up to the HS6 digit, the trade data are the same. But below 6 digit, the classification differs. As a result of that, we are going to get a very interesting scenario. Let me look at it with one practical example. Suppose we are going to look at Indian export of, say you are exporting t-shirts from India or similar textile products to America. So the classification is 610990. Suppose you go to any of the trade database, you draw the data. For HS610990, you find under this product category, India is exporting 5 different product classification to America. I'm not looking at the exact definition of each one of them because of the paucity of space, but you can understand there are 5 different products. What we see, 90, 10 and 20, these products are being traded relatively more. 30 and 40, these two products are being traded relatively less. But we can see India's total export to America is relatively high. Suppose you try to look at America's import of this same product, 610990 from India. We find number of products by which America is trading with India is very large, which is obvious because the classification is different. You are exporting only watermelon, a single code, but America is dividing your product in 4 different codes. So as a result of that, the number of codes are more. But a very interesting thing happens. If you take a total summation of all the products India is exporting to America, US is importing from India, you will find the total summation is much lesser than Indian export to US. So there is a interesting mismatch we are getting. If you look at Government of India data, we are exporting, let's say, 152,000 worth value. And if you look at this, we are exporting only around 46,000 worth value. Why this huge difference? There are a couple of reasons by which we can explain this. One reason we might say, the product can be intended to go for America, but suppose America reject the product at entry point. There is a high probability then the exporter will sell the product in Mexico or Colombia. He will not take it back to India. So in Indian data, it will keep showing as export to US, but in reality, US has not imported it. There is a second possibility. The product comes to America, from America it goes to Mexico. And there is a third possibility. America imports it, use it in making a final product, and then exporting it to another country under a different name. So as a result of that, we will not be able to exactly match it. So this is the reason for why it is very important for you to understand whether a product not only simply exported from India, but whether it is also being imported by America. Only when both are happening, you can say, well, indeed there is a good market for India to export to the America. So that's it about the background of the HS code and while you use the trade databases, the reasons why you have to be very careful. Now, let's go to the trade map database, one of the very important crucial database. Let's use that and see how you can identify market by using the same. Let me stop sharing the PPT for a second and then I'm going to share the my Internet Explorer so that you can use this app. One thing I will request, if you can give me a HS6-digit product, any of you have used it earlier, if so, then I can use that for the analysis for identifying a product. Anybody would like to share a product code with me? You can type in the chat and give it to me. We can use the same. Anybody would like to give a product, or I can do with a product of my choice. Okay, then maybe I'm doing with one product of my choice for the time being. Any product that you give to me, then maybe what we can do, we can go for one particular option. So let me just try to go for this product here. Let's say 610910 we can take as the product, the t-shirt that we considered earlier. What I'm doing here, let me stop sharing the PPT and let me come and share my internet browser. Let me share the grid map window here. This is a tool developed by International Trade Center in collaboration with World Bank and UNCTAD. So you can get the trade data given to all the country governments, to ITC, and this is a official data. The advantage is, in one go you can get the data from all the countries. You don't need to go to Government of India's official database and Government of America's official database. So you can create your own user ID, your office ID, your personal Gmail ID, or any ID you can go for. Once you enter, you will come to a query page like this. So what you can do, first you have to select the product by chapter initially, then by heading, subheading, and you can go for your analysis. You can select the exporting country, and then you can select the partner country. By partner, we mean here the country which will be either exporting or importing from India. You can select the trade flow, export or import. You can select the trade frequency. It can be a yearly time series, quarterly data, or trade indicators. You can go by product, by country, and you can also go by the product cluster. So let's look at the selection of the product. Suppose I first go for 610910. First I go for 61. Then from 61, what we can do, we can go for 6109. And once we select 6109, we can click on 610910 here. I'm sorry, I didn't change that trade flow to export. We are interested in Indian export, right? So India exports we go for, and then what we do, we go for India export, click on the country code. Once we click on the country code, it will give us the list of the countries who are importing a particular product from India. So here what we are getting, we get over the last 5 years, the Indian export to these countries. If you want, you can export, increase the number of columns to 10 years. You can increase it to 20 years. So it will just show the data accordingly. Let me just stick to the 5 years format. Now, what we do, suppose you want to understand which country is the best market for India. You are getting the data. You can see export is increasing how in America or UAE or Nigeria. Suppose you are a bit confused, you cannot make out which market can be a relatively good market. Let's say for America, what we observe, there Indian export is declining. Can it be a good market? We need to look into that. So first, what we do, we go for trade indicator. We click on in the drop down menu instead of yearly time series, trade indicators, and the trade indicator come to our view. So what we do, we observe that it gives all the countries to which India export, what are the key features. How are you going to interpret the key feature? Well, let me look at a couple of very important factors that you must keep in mind when you interpret this. Let's let's see it in the following manner. Suppose we look at the share in India's exports first. If a country is having a very large share in Indian export, that's definitely an advantage. And what we do, we consider fine, US, UAE, they have a very large share in Indian export. Next, what we can consider is, what is the ranking of the partner country in world import? US is number one country, so that's definitely a good option. UAE is 17, a mid-level market. Nigeria is actually a very marginal market. Their rank in the world import is very low. We can actually see that from the share of the partner countries in world import. America is having a share of 15%, UAE 1.6%, and Nigeria 0.01%. Now, what we need to see is what had been the import growth in the partner country. 6% is the import growth in the world. So we can observe that there had been a modest import growth in the last 5 years, the average growth. Now in America, we see the average growth had been modest. On the other hand, UAE and Nigeria, the import growth had been relatively higher. So we can see, as compared to other players in the world, which country is having a relatively higher import growth. We also need to look at the last column, which shows the import imposed by the country on Indian export. We see America is having lower import growth and a very high tariff. UAE, a modest import growth, but a relatively higher import growth and a very relatively low tariff rate. Nigeria, on the other hand, having a higher import growth, but a very high tariff rate as well. So you can try to understand from here which country should become a possible import growth rate. Now, here, let's observe one important criteria. In case you are not able to decipher the import possibility in a country by looking simply into this particular table, then we can go to the graphical tools. So we click on the graph. So once we click on the graph, then what we observe, trade map is helping us by putting the countries in various color code. Just to make the analysis easier, let me remove there are 20 countries and the country circles are falling over one another. Let's just take 10 countries. So we come to 10 countries. Okay. Now, let's try to make the analysis. I think just give me a second. I have to log in once again because grid maps, that's the only problem with this. It logs one out on a periodic basis. Sorry. So let me go ahead once again with the analysis. It's good that we had this scenario. Now you know that some of the time grid map will log you out. If you don't use it for some time, it happens. Okay, so let me just jump into 610910 directly. 610910, the product export by India. Now we have the list of countries. Now what we do, we go for the trade indicator to understand the market characteristics, countries which are importing the product from India. Now, once we do that, we go for graph. And once we go there, suppose I remove a couple of countries, make it 1 to 10. In fact, the 1 to 10 is by ranking in Indian import. What you can do, you can just keep changing the numbers. You can go for 11 to 20, 21 to 30 for understanding the markets. I leave this to you for playing with the graphical tool analysis. Let me stick to 1 to 10. Now, how do we observe the outcome here? In the vertical axis, we are looking at growth by the import in countries. I think you all noted the growth rate, import growth rate of UAE and Nigeria had been 12%. So you see in a coordinate geometry sense, they are much ahead of other countries. On the other hand, the import growth rate of America was 2%. So America is at the bottom. On the vertical horizontal axis, we are measuring the share of the partner countries in India's exports. America is having a much larger share. UAE also has a large share. Other countries are having a relatively nominal share in Indian import. Sorry, Indian export basket. Okay. Two more things we need to look into. Trade map is trying to help you by making this analysis three-dimensional. In otherwise two-dimensional representation. How are they doing that? If you look at the circle called America or UAE and take the cursor on the American circle, you will find the share of the circle is defined by the share in world import. So the volume of the circle, that is area of the circle, is actually depicting the share of the country in world import, which is highest for America, modest for UAE, and very low for Nigeria. So ideally you should target a relatively bigger circle. Second thing, we have some yellow bubbles and we have some blue bubbles. What are the yellow bubbles? The yellow bubbles are showing a scenario where, let's say, Indian export growth to the country, to America, suppose, is 3%. But America's total import from the world is increasing by 7%, which means America is having a very large import propensity from the world, but India is entering the American market with a relatively less potential or a less export growth rate. Why should this happen? It can happen if Indian export product quality is relatively lower, America is using some non-tariff barrier on Indian export, there exists some degree of tariff on India, etc. On the other hand, Netherlands, for instance, and Nigeria, for instance, are blue bubbles. What is the blue bubble? It's just the other way. Suppose India's export growth rate to the other countries is 5%. The other country's import growth rate from rest of the world is 2%. That means India's entry in that particular country is much larger than the other country. So India is a net winner in the market. So to summarize this, the yellow bubbles show the scenario where the country India is a modest player in that market. The blue bubble shows where India is a winner. So as a result of that, what we can say, the blue bubbles are the markets which India can target immediately. Yellow bubbles are the market which can be a future growth market. That is, you have to identify what is the problem there exactly. Is it a problem linked to tariff? Then India may need to negotiate with America for tariff reduction. Is it a problem because of product quality standard? Then India need to negotiate with America for not putting very high standard on Indian export, and so on. Now, suppose you cannot make out from here which country you should export to. Then go to the drop down menu where we are looking at the a different graph type. So in the different graph type, when you select, you will find let me make it 10 countries. You will find that it is defining the countries in a very interesting manner. We saw earlier that 6% is the import growth rate by all countries in the world, or global average import for this particular HS6 digit code. So what trade map is telling you that which countries are witnessing a higher growth rate in terms of the average import growth scenario. There is a red line you will observe. The red line is showing the world average import growth rate. The countries displaying import growth rate above that are called dynamic markets. Countries with an import growth rate below the red line are called the declining markets, or less preferred markets, or so. So what we are doing here, you can definitely target Netherlands and Nigeria in short run because they are preferred markets, dynamic markets. Dynamic meaning there is a relatively higher import growth, and because the average import growth rate is above the world average. On the other hand, all the yellow markets below the red line, they are markets for the long run where import growth is less. So you have to really focus why in these individual countries your import, India's export is not increasing. Maybe we can go to US and try to check the scenario. Why in US the import growth is not happening? Italy, Spain and UAE on the other hand are yellow bubbles but above the red line. So you can actually export to these markets with a relative ease. Now let me go to a third type of analysis. We have done two type of analysis so far. Analysis one, where we tried to look into the general scenario by looking into the bubble graph. The second analysis is like this, where we are getting the red line generated by the trade map, and from there we are trying to identify how which market we can consider as a dynamic market. Now we look at something in a slightly different manner. Suppose you want to know which product India is becoming more competitive over the period and which product India is losing competitiveness over the period. Within HS6109, how can we do that? For that, what we do, we need to go one step up. 6109. So we just go to the product selection drop down menu, click on 6109, and then we go for, instead of by country, we go for by product. Once we do that, we get the products classified under four different boxes. Let me define how are we getting the boxes. We see in the vertical axis, it's showing annual growth of import by the products during the last 5 years. So we know 6% had been the import growth rate for 610910, and for 610990, the import growth rate had been 0%, average import growth rate over the last 5 year period. So vertical axis, we see for each HS6 digit level, what had been the average import growth rate. 5% is the import growth for world trade, that is all the products. Horizontal axis, please understand it bit carefully. Here we are having a vertical line drawn from the point zero. What do we mean here? Zero means in horizontal axis we note annual change of India's share in world exports in the last 5 years. Now, if India is becoming more in export of a particular product, what would happen? We can understand India's share in world export is going to increase because we are becoming more competitive over the period. On the other hand, if our export is becoming less competitive, say China or Bangladesh or Vietnam, they are gaining at the expense of India, then what would happen? Obviously, our share in world export is going to fall. Suppose India's share for a particular product is 1%. And at the end of 5 years, our average share is increasing to 1.10%. Then we say our share has increased by 10%. From 1% to 1.10%. On the other hand, suppose then we are gaining competitiveness, and it will be on the right hand side of the vertical line drawn at zero. On the other hand, if India is becoming less competitive in a product, suppose again for simplicity, our share in the world export was 1% earlier. Now India's share is declining to, let's say, 0.85%, then we are going to say India's share declined by 15%, and it will fall on the left hand side of the vertical line drawn at zero. So we are getting now four different quadrants. The northeast quadrant is named winner in growing sector. Why winner? Because the product is on the right hand side. That means India's share is increasing in world export. Why it is growing sector? Because world import of the product is 6% and 5%. World import of that product is 6%. So that product is demanded more as compared to other countries, other products. If we are in the northwest box, losers in growing sector. Import is high, but India's share in world export is declining. So we have to be again very careful and try to understand why our share is declining in that particular product. If we look into southwest box, loser in declining sector, India's competitiveness is falling because our share in world export is declining and the product is not being demanded. Finally, in southeast box, winner in declining sector. India's share is increasing in that particular product, but in world trade, the product's import is not growing. So we have four very interesting type of possible options. Just to summarize, the northeast box, winner in growing sector, is the best box. Our competitiveness increasing, demand for the product increasing. We couldn't have asked for a better option. The southwest box is the worst box. Our competitiveness is declining, world demand for the product is also declining. So no respite. Let's spend a minute on the two other boxes. Losers in growing sector, one. So here what we get is that world import for the product is growing, but India's share in world export is declining. We have to understand what is the reason behind it. One option might be all the countries to whom India is exporting the product, they are charging a very high tariff. So it's nothing to do with the competitiveness of the product per se, of India per se, but it is the trade barrier. Then you may discuss with the government officials through DGFT or Ministry of Commerce outreach programs that what government of India should do to negotiate with key markets for tariff reduction. Second, what it may happen, India's product is of a very medium quality. We try to export the product, but the other country is asking for a better quality and they perhaps it is a food product. There is some residue of some chemical there which they don't want to allow import of. So here again, what India can do, we can discuss, negotiate with the country and try to get a better deal in terms of harmonized policy framework. The other country acknowledge the product standard of India as equivalent to their own. Lastly, there can be a third option. The other countries not increasing tariff against India, they are neither having any technical standard, but suppose they enter into an FTA with China, and now to China they are giving a tariff rate of 0% because these two countries are preferential trade agreement partners. In that case, India is going to face a challenge and our exports are going to get compromised. So depending on why India is losing competitiveness, you may try to discuss with the government for providing you respite accordingly. Second, if we look at the southeast box, in the southeast box, what we observe, India is the winner, but the sector is declining. Here also, we may think of two different possible options. One option is the product India is exporting is a dot matrix printer. That is, it's a sunset product. We cannot hope to increase our share. We cannot hope to reverse the clock in world trade and increase global import of the product. In that case, maybe India will enjoy the advantage. After all, we are winner for some more time, but maybe then you need to think of diversifying to another product as well, because ultimately this product is a sunset product, a dot matrix printer. There is a second option we can consider, which would be, suppose the product is a luxury product. The demand for the product is low, not because of any fault of yours, but there had been a global recession, as a result of which world import is relatively lower. So as a result of that, your product also other countries are not importing. That's why you are getting the placement of the product in this box. So in that case, you may have many things to do in terms of marketing and advertising expenses, etc., but you may yet not think about diversifying. So that's it. These are some of the ways in which the TradeMap graphical tools can be utilized, and you can try to draw very crucial conclusions out of these. So let me stop on this particular form here. What we can do, we can try to look at, let's say, what is the scenario in America or UAE? Can India compete against other countries in long run in these particular markets? For that purpose, suppose we go back once again to 610910. We get 610910 here. We go by country, and now we click on USA. Now what we try to understand, what is the scenario for India here? We see that India's export is increasing only modestly. We have seen that Indian export is increasing only by 2% in the American market. Why that might be happening? We see, who are the major exporters to America? Honduras, El Salvador, China, Mexico, Haiti, Dominican Republic, Vietnam, after India, Guatemala, Bangladesh, Peru. So I'm sure all of you are noticing here, the countries that are enjoying advantage in American market, one, they are like China, so they have a very high degree of technical advantage in recent period. Second, Bangladesh, which is enjoying because of Japanese and South Korean investment in garment sector of Bangladesh. And an LDC. The less developed countries, they enjoy a 0% tariff in developed countries. That is a very crucial advantage. And we find Honduras, Nicaragua, El Salvador, all the Latin American countries, they enjoy a special economic treaty with America. Moreover, the transportation cost of taking garments from these countries to America is relatively lower. So that's the reason why these countries are enjoying in American market. Now, instead of value, we can go for share in value in percentage. So what we observe here, Honduras is showing a fluctuation, of course, but they are not going below 12%. Nicaragua, we see they are actually showing an increase in market share. El Salvador, a slight decrease in the recent period. Same for China, decline as we observe. India has been able to keep its share almost constant after an initial fall. Why this might be happening? One reason for that is, in the drop down menu, instead of percentage share, you can try to go towards the unit value. That is, what is the price of the product that is in being exported by India as compared to other countries? Let me look at the data. What we see, India's price has come down over the period, but compared to the other countries, Honduras, Nicaragua, El Salvador, China, Mexico, Haiti, Dominican Republic, is it cheaper? It is not. So as a result of that, what we can say, because labor is cheaper in these countries, there is a possibility they will also get more FDI. That is, global corporates are going and setting up their production unit there to take the advantage of the American market. So what you can do, you can compare, say, drawing the data from trade map in two different columns. One, you look at the market share, one you look at the unit price. So you try to make out whether by using the trade data, whether by having a relatively lower price, India should be able to capture the market in America in a much better fashion. It seems one reason why in America, India has not been able to play a huge role is the average price of the product is relatively higher as compared to the other Latin American countries. So this is how some of the ways in which we can use the trade map tools. Of course, trade map tools can be used in lot many other ways for computing varied trade indices, etc. as well. We can go to the computation of trade indices at a later point if time permits. We can go for some other trade databases, how they can be utilized for understanding the various characteristics. The second trade database, I think one exporter must be using, is that of the market access map. How can we utilize the market access map? The market access map is also developed by ITC. You can just use the same user ID and password that you are using for accessing the trade map data. So please go ahead with that. Let me just go for login. So you just type market access map in Google. When this page comes, just go for account. I'm just signing in by using my Gmail account here. Now, there can be very many tariff or trade barrier related data that you must be using. Suppose you go for compare. Under the compare tool, say I go for markets. I go for India as the exporter. Say we keep all the destination country, that is the countries to which India can export the product, and we go for 610910, the product we just looked into earlier. We go for search. So what we find, for all the WTO member countries, it's showing what is the MFN duty that is there. Let's go for the map. In the map, you will find it's showing the same information, that is import duty imposed by various countries on India, but in a pictorial sense. So you can clearly make out how the two set of countries are going to impose tariff barrier or other form of barrier on India. The way in which you can evaluate the scenario in India is the following. You can look at the effective applied tariffs, and the effective applied tariffs, what we find, will be represented across countries in color code. If a country is not having any trade barrier, that is tariff is 0%, then a very light color code will be used, say Australia in this example. No, Australia, the applied tariff is 5%. China also is 3.9%. So which means there is no country using a 0% tariff on India for this particular product. Second, here now we are getting the import value. So you will find there is a bubble on each country. If you take the cursor on one particular country, suppose America, we will find it will show, sorry, Canada, I have took the bubble too. You can take it to America here. The applied tariff will be 16.5%. Number of non-tariff measures. Non-tariff measures will be the product quality and technical standards that a country can use on other country imports. Let's say, if America is importing t-shirt or other form of shirts, what they can do, they might ask India that for dyeing the shirt, the cotton, the fiber or fabric, the exporter must use only the natural dyes. No chemical dye, which can be carcinogenic in long run, should be used. So that is a non-tariff barrier or NTM. Non-tariff measures. You can see the number of non-tariff measures here, and the trade volume is being shown by the shape of the circle here. If India is trading more with another country, then the sphere, the trade sphere, will be relatively larger. If not much trade is happening, then the circle will be relatively smaller. So what we can say, target of EU should be to identify a country where the sphere is relatively larger and the country is imposing a relatively lower tariff. Of course, we can see a scenario where despite using a lower tariff, maybe India's total export is relatively less. That we can explain by, one, if that country is imposing some degree of trade barrier on India. Second, in that country, there is no demand actually for that product. The demand we had earlier is a one-off exception. that is technically very much possible. So what we can do here, we can change it to number of NTM . So we see in all countries where NTM exist, the countries are being represented by the again different type of bubble codes. We can just take the cursor there and understand what is the degree of trade barriers, the non-tariff measure bubbles that are existing. What you can also do here, we are looking at it all the continent. You can go by Africa. So one set of country you look at in a much close quarter. You can go for Asia, you can go for Europe or any country. You will find that the market access tool, market access map tool, is giving you the idea about where to trade. Now, trade map and market access map are not substitute to each other. They are actually complementary. You are getting some of the graphical tools from trade map. You are now coming to the market access map to evaluate what are the trade barriers therein and trade growth. So both trade map and market access map, the output, if you match, you are going to get a much better form of projection about which country ideally you should be exporting. So let me stop on this particular database as well. You need to play with this particular database. Okay, one more thing I think we can look at, that will be we considered market earlier. We can compare competitors. Suppose we click here on compare and then click on competitors. We can consider exporting country all. Destination country or importer can be United States of America. And 610910 is our product. We go ahead with that. Once we click on that, we get what is the tariff rate imposed by America on all countries, the MFN tariff, most favored nation tariff. Tariff imposed by a country on all WTO members is 16.5, but America is giving some preferential tariffs. So let's click on map. What we find in this example is the trade values and average tariff is clearly given. Canada and Mexico, Australia, they are a relatively lower tariff. The idea is nothing, but America having free trade agreement with Canada and Mexico, the NAFTA, North American Free Trade Area, with Australia, US is having a trade agreement. So in all of them, there is a relatively lower tariff. And what we see, import is different. From Australia, import is much lower. But from Canada and Mexico, America is importing a lot. On the other hand, countries like Chad, as you can see, America is charging 0% tariff on exports coming from Chad. But what we see here, Chad is not really exporting the product to America. And neither did Sudan. So the two countries, despite having a very modest tariff rate against these countries, they can't enter the American market. Perhaps it has something to do with poor product quality from this market, can be the transportation cost or so on. To understand which one is the right reason, we have to go into these two countries' data. We cannot offhand determine which is the right product for us. Now, let's go for the third database that we may consider, which is called the India Trade Portal. India Trade Portal is a Government of India database. Market Access Map and Trade Map, remember, as we discussed, these two were the Government of India data. These two were the International Trade Center data. So global trade was involved. That's the reason why we are getting the tariff America is imposing on Australia or Canada. In India Trade Portal, we are going to get very detailed data, because here we are looking at data given by Government of India. But we are only going to get the data that India imposed on another country or another country imposed on India. We are not going to get things like, for instance, UK imposing a tariff against, let's say, China. That will not be possible to get from the India Trade Portal. So what is the advantage of India Trade Portal then, when we try to use this? The India Trade Portal advantage is we can get lot many additional information which are not available in ITC, Market Access Map and Trade Map. So how can we get that? Suppose we here again write 610910 in the India Trade Portal box and just go for search. Now, we are interested obviously in export. So we click on export here, and as we discussed earlier, remember, there is a single port. There are not more than one ports. So we click on the 610910, go for next. We then have to select to which country we would like to export the product. Say we want to export to Japan or South Korea as an example. Suppose we go for Japan. And then we click for next. In Japan, there are two product codes under which the product is classified. You have to read which is the best code explaining your product. And then we go for next. Well, this is a bliss point actually. We see most favored nation tariff imposed by Japan is 10.9%. However, because India and Japan are part of the Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement, bilateral, Japan is charging a duty of 0% against India. So, India would actually be able to enter the Japan market with a tariff preference of 10.9%, which is a good option. There are a couple of other things that you can use here. You can go for SPS TBT. These are the sanitary and phytosanitary condition and technical barrier to trade. Two different form of product standard related condition that you should be very careful to know. So you can just click on each one of the link and check what the provision has on Indian export. You can check the export policy. We find here this export policy, general t-shirts, etc., that is free to export. But if suppose somebody would like to write some phrase, verses from the Holy Quran, then it is restricted. Maybe the government of India would first check that the verse, etc., they are printed properly or so. Only then they are going to give the export license. So we see generally it's free export, but for certain type there is a degree of restriction involved. Remember, this is imposed by government of India, export policy. SPSTPT is import policy, so that is imposed by Japanese government. We can also check the provision of duty drawback. So the drawback rate that is applicable by the government of India policy, we can see the drawback rate is 2.1% for the first product, 1.5 for the other remaining products. So you can check what is the government policy for helping the domestic production of this particular variety. You can also go for the interest subvention. So under the MSME scheme for the medium small enterprises, whether there is any MSME provision, the merchant export rate, you can also try to work out. You can also try to see it from the MEIS code here. Here what we see, this is not available. You can also try to see the GST and other levies, what the GST rate, etc. You can get the details. So essentially what we get is the following. We are trying to understand, when we try to export to a number of countries, one, what are the government policies? We can say, we can look at three different challenges. One, when you produce the product for export from India trade portal, you can make out what are the government support policy for production. One, second, what are the government support policy towards export through MEIS, etc. Third, you are going to look into when the product is entering the other country market, like let's say Japan or US, what is the tariff the country imposes on India? From where can we get it? We get it from the market access map. And lastly, what we are trying to see is, when you are exporting to a particular market, which other countries are the competitors who are trying to enter to your market? So from the trade map database and the graphical tools in particular, we can make out exactly which country can be a relatively better option for India to export the product. So this is how the three databases can be utilized properly. Now, what I can do, I will just go with all the products that we considered in very quick succession, one by one, in the next 5-10 minutes, so that all the possible applications that we considered, we can have a recap of them and you can use it. Let me do it the other way around. Suppose we can take the leather wallet example, the 420232. So let's say I go to home. we click on the product code exports, and then we get a couple of examples that are coming to say, I select this, next, I think we first go for the trademark. That will be relatively better for us to link it. So by the policy, we know we have to select India as the country, trade flow exports, we select 4202, and then we go for 32. We see India is exporting to a number of countries. US and Japan are the two largest markets for us. So we go for trade indicators. Let's say we jump directly to the graphical tools, and we go for the top 10 countries. We see all the countries are kind of superimposed on each other. America is a blue market, which is, we know, is a short-term market. So definitely a preferred market, we can say, but to understand whether it's a dynamic market or not, we have to go for the next type of graphical representation, bubble graph on Indian export growth versus partner import growth. So we click on that, and what we see, it's showing the dynamic and declining markets very clearly. So the blue dynamic markets should be the markets we immediately can try to export to. Blue declining markets, we will try to export, but we'll also try to identify what is the problem with the declining market, because the declining market is defining by import growth rate in that country is lower than the world import growth rate. So we will try to understand which factor is responsible for that. Third, the yellow markets, they are the long-term markets. We are going to consider, again, in these markets, what can be the practical concerns? In these markets, like China, for instance, is a dynamic market, but Indian export growth to China is lower than China's import from the world. So we have to go to the market and check which countries are replacing India. Are they some general country or regional trade agreement partner of China? Accordingly, we have to strategize our export policy. And finally, we have to look into 420232 and try to understand how are we going to work out that whether the product is a relatively better product for export from India. For that, remember what we do. We go to 4202. And go by product. We see all the HS 6-digit codes under 4202 are being shown here. Now, 420232 is the product which we are interested to know about. 420232 is here. 420232 is in the northeast box, winner in growing sector. This is showing that India is increasing its market share in the world market, which is quite good, and world import of the product is also growing. So if you are exporting 420232, you are good. However, suppose you are exporting 420221. So world import is increasing, but India's share in world export is declining. So the problem is at India's end. You have to see what might be the problem associated with it. If you are exporting 420231, it's in the southwest corner, showing that India is losing out in this product. The product itself also showing a decline, relative decline in demand. So maybe there is some serious problem in import trade of this product category. And finally, if you are exporting 420211, this is good. Why we say good? Because though world import of the product is falling, India is a major winner country. So you have to understand why world import of this product is falling. And accordingly, you need to strategize your plan. I just realized one thing I have not shown earlier. Suppose we go to 420232 and we select world as the reporter. Export as the trade flow and data by country. So we get what are the share of the countries in this export. Suppose we look at the data for 10-year period, and instead of value, we go for share in value in percentage. We see China is the winner in this category, hands down. They account for more than 50% of world trade. Other countries like France, Italy are among the leading players. Where is India? India's share has declined significantly, no doubt, from 0.1 to 0.5% share in world export. So there had been a very sharp 500% growth, but or five times growth. But there is a very significant possibility of India to grow its share in the world market. Now, if we try to look into, suppose, Netherlands, USA, these markets, we are going to go to India trade portal. We go to home. We click on the product, we go for export, we select one of the product code, next. Suppose we want to see in France, in United States, these countries whether India is enjoying any form of trade advantage. We go for next. In France, we read the description of the product. Select this, select that. Go for next. And what we see, in France, the MFN tariff is 9.7%. India is facing the MFN tariff. So is US. 20% is the MFN tariff. India faced the MFN tariff only. So we see by tariff margin, we are not going to benefit any special advantage in that market. So we have to understand what is the merchandise export MEIS scheme from India, are we getting any MEIS rate support for export? What we see? Yes, there is a 3% support, which is good for us. So these are the ways in which we can try to work out the possible option in this particular scenario. Now we can try to go for some other trade database as well, some other ways in which these trade databases can be used as well. We can consider, for instance, this some of the key trade indices by which we can try to consider whether there would be advantage enjoyed by India when we are trying to enter one particular market. How can we compute the particular market by using these particular trade databases? Well, we can try to see it in the following manner. Suppose we now try to understand that while we are going to export this particular product, say 420232 to particular market. Now in that particular market, what is the advantage India enjoys? Say we go to trade map for this particular product 420232, we go to the America market, we click on United States of America. We compare the advantage India enjoys with respect to other countries. Well, here I don't think India is a major player. So let's go back and select another country. Let's try with UK. We see in UK also, India is not really a major exporter. Let me do it the other way around. Let's see, India in which country is a major exporter? So we go for India as an exporter. We see this product, India is exporting majorly to US. But we have seen already in American market, India is not really a major player. So let's try to go for the Japanese market. Let's say we consider Japan here. In country we select Japan. We go for imports. Now we see, yes, then we find India. The India's share is here. So let's say what we try to do, we try to take the data from trade map in an Excel file and try to compare the scenario over the period. Suppose we try to download the data here, we click on the Excel, then the file would come. I have not mentioned it explicitly. If we have to download something, we can just click it on the X here, the Excel file will open. W if we click, the Word file will open. Or if we want to open it as a text file, we click on this icon here. So we now have the Excel file. suppose we just take the data for the top 5-10 countries, India and others. We want to see how over the period the scenario has changed for each one of them. After we get the share of various countries in the import by the partner countries, here we see this is share in value in Japan's import. So we say that the share of China in Japan's import is almost 50%. Share of France in Japan import is this. Share of Italy is this. So we get the data here. Now the next what we require is the unit value. That is, when Japan is importing the product from these partner countries, what is the average import value that we are getting? So what we can do, we can again try to download the Excel here. The Excel will be downloaded. We can click once again on that file and we can open this in. Once we do, we can take the data for the figures in one single Excel file. Let me share the Excel file with you. Let me stop sharing the internet for a second. Let me go for sharing the Excel file here. Yeah. So we see that we are collecting the data here, market share in the Japanese import of various exporting countries, unit price of export of various countries in Japanese market. So what we can do, we can look at the average scenario over the period. Compare two 5-year period averages. We look over the period of 2010 to 14, what had been the average share of China, and over the period of 2015 to 19, what had been the share of the countries once again. So we see the average will be very clearly observed. We can now compute the difference. That is, over the period, the share of China in Japan's import is increasing or decreasing. Or we can consider it change in market share. We can now repeat the same for the unit price. We see that there is again the average unit price for 2010 and 14, 15 and 19 we can determine. Now we can compare the result that we are getting for the two. So the change in market share, change in unit price we can observe. Now what are we going to do? We are going to keep expanding the columns. For instance, we are going to see what is Japan's tariff on various countries. How can we know what is Japan's tariff on various countries? We can get that from the market access map. Let me keep writing that. and get the market access map. What is Japan's tariff against the countries? Let's say the tariff by Japan is 0%, but Japan is imposing a 3% tariff on Cambodia, 5% tariff on China, 2% tariff on Vietnam. You can then realize that India would be enjoying certain degree of advantage against these countries. Then what else we require? We also require something very important. The merchandise export promotion scheme. When India is trying to export to the market, what is the merchandise export promotion scheme we are having? If we find that India is getting 5% merchandise export promotion scheme for exporting to Japan, then this is actually giving India some degree of advantage that we are going to enjoy in the market. We can also going to add columns like this then. For instance, we can have a regional trade agreement column. We know with Japan, there is a regional trade agreement India is having. We can write that as yes. Other countries, we can keep writing it as whether there is a regional trade agreement or not. For instance, China, there is, we know, a regional trade agreement. France, there is no regional trade agreement. So we can use the trade map and we can take it from the other trade databases, market access map, India trade portal, etc., in the following manner. So you can use this particular advantage very effectively for understanding how India can export a product to another market with relative ease. One last thing that we can consider from the trade map. Let me stop sharing and go to the trade map database once again. The last option that we can consider the trade map database is the companies that you can get the data from. What is the idea here? We can see after the table, graph and map, there is a company level data. So the idea is you can try to get some of the corporates in the other countries to whom you can export your product. But there is a catch you may need to remember. Let me come down at the bottom of the table. We see this is showing Japanese Ministry of Finance is the source of the data. If we go to India for a second, suppose India's export or import of a particular product, say we want to look into India's export of a particular product here. Suppose we go to values, not the unit data. We see here the data is obtained from DGCIS, Directorate General of Commercial Intelligence and Statistics. That means, like Japanese Ministry of Finance, that is a pure government data we talk about. However, suppose we now look at Japan as the country, or let's say we can go for US as a country on the imports, and we go for companies. We see that there is only one company they are giving who are importing this following product under the category clothing, footwear, fur, leather goods, fashion accessories, etc. The company's website is given, so you can just click on the website and get the details of theirs. You can just click on the company here and you can get a basic idea. So you can essentially check about this company in greater detail. The thing you need to understand here, in no way we are actually saying that there is a single firm in America who is importing this particular product. Because here you see the source is Compass. In some of the cases you might find the source is Dun and Bradstreet. It is a private company who is giving the data to TradeMap. Idea is Compass or Dun and Bradstreet and other corporates, they are maintaining a portal, and the corporates who are paying a subscription to them, Compass or Dun and Bradstreet only giving their name. So in reality, there can be thousands of corporates in America who would be importing this product from you. So you have to also look into other databases. Here, you are only getting a small portion of the data that can be accessed for understanding the scenario. So these are some of the ways in which we can make a practical use of the databases, we can consider here the the TradeMap database, which would give us the actual trade data coming from various countries. We can then consider about the market access database, which are the data which will give not the monetary value of the trade data. In fact, in TradeMap, why I am saying only the trade value, it will show the share, it will give you the graphical tools, it will give you the unit value of export, and lot many ways in which it is going to help you in understanding which market you can export the product to. You can also see a target country from which other countries they are importing the product from. On the other hand, the market access map, it is going to give you the import scenario. You can see various countries, what is the tariff rate they are imposing on the trade partners. So, TradeMap to be used for tariff analysis, market access map to be used for, TradeMap to be used for the trade data, market share, market identification analysis, market access map to be used for the tariff understanding, trade barrier analysis, and India Trade Portal you are going to use for understanding the government support for doing business, Government of India. So the merchandise export promotion scheme support, duty drawback, interest subvention, GST, etc. The policy framework, everything you can get. In addition, India Trade Portal is also telling you when you are exporting to a particular market, what is the tariff preference you are getting in that market, as well as the technical standards they impose on your product. So everything taken, the three databases taken collectively would give you a fair idea about doing international business, how you can approach the market and reach the scenario effectively. So let me stop on the discussion. Let me answer some of the questions, very important questions you have come out with. First, there is a question on the SCOMIT list. Okay, SCOMIT list products, they are not given under the HS code. Therefore, SCOMIT list, there is a separate classification that exists under the DGFT website. So you can check giving by the search SCOMIT and you can get the information. There is a question from Mr. Darshan, Brass Manufacturing. Your product code is 8538. Thank you for sharing your code. I think what you should do, you should actually apply the ways in which we discussed the scenario here, you can exactly follow the steps going into TradeMap first. You identify the exact HS6-digit code of your product's export, and you accordingly identify the market from TradeMap, identify the barrier from the market access map, and then you check the Government of India policy that's being given through the India Trade portal. Mr. Arun asked the question, what happens for the incorrect specification classification of the product? A very important query, actually. If it depends, actually, country to country. In some country, they might allow you to reclassify your product correctly. Suppose there are two products under that particular HS6-digit code. Say I'm using the product code of Mr. Darshan. Suppose there are two codes, 853810 and 853890. And for both the products, the tariff rate is 0%. You should have written 8510, but just by say a typo error, you typed 8590. The importing authorities, because both products are having a tariff of 0%, might allow you to reclassify the product, change the form. However, in some countries, suppose 853810, there is a 0% tariff, and 853890 is 20% tariff. Your product is 853890. By mistake, you typed 853810. There is a possibility the importing country might interpret it as you are trying to bunk the import duty. That's why you deliberately misclassified the number. They might, in that case, impose a hefty fine on you, or essentially there will be administrative delays, etc. So to answer your question, Mr. Arun, it would depend on that country. What is the import duty of the two codes, the right code and the wrong code? If the two codes both are having 0% duty and you can convince the authorities that just by mistake it has happened, maybe a nominal fine might be imposed. But if in that country there is a huge difference, they might take a very conservative interpretation of that. Yes, Mr. Arun, second question, that is definitely true. Remember, that's the reason why we checked the classification difference between India and US initially. Yes, the customer is very right. We all know the customer is the king, right? So you have to read what is the exact classification. How can you do that? Go to TradeMap. Go to the exact 8 or 10 digit classification. Make out exactly what should be the ideal HS 10 digit classification in America and the corresponding Indian code. Mr. Arun asked the next question, also a very important thing: how to cross check if your classification is correct. Well, we all know there might be the case that in India there are 4 HS 8 digit codes and in America there are 15 HS 10 digit codes. That's the reason why you should go for India Trade Portal. Remember what was happening? A couple of indicative codes were being shown. So once you select your HS 8 digit codes, the correct code, then Government of India is narrowing the search for you. You don't need to look at all HS 10 digit 15 product lines. You are doing it for only 4 to 5 codes, which Government of India is matching to the right approximation. So you have to go back to TradeMap, match them and cross check it, just in case you are a bit unsure that whether the classification you are looking at is right or not. One option could be if there is an export promotion council, say Capaxil, Camaxil, Pharmaceutical Export Promotion Council, Gems and Jewelry Export Promotion Council. One council exists and you are member of that council. You can always go there and double check it with their export desk. There is a third option. Suppose for your product, there is no Export Promotion Council, but there is FICCI, CII, or a Chamber of Commerce. You can go there and you can check with them. FICCI and CII, we know they have a commodity desk. So in the commodity desk, someone would be able to clarify your question there. There is a question. A couple of you have given me the code. I'm extremely sorry. That time I asked you the question, I waited for a few seconds and then I went for the analysis with my code. I should have actually come back once again in the chat. I could have used your codes. Thanks for sharing your codes with me. We should have tried with N95 mask. That is going to be one of the majorly traded product in the coming days. Many of you have given me a code. Sorry, I couldn't use one of them. Maybe what we can do, we can, you can just keep playing with that. The three databases that we discussed, there is one question once again. Clearing and forwarding agent license, etc. I think I'll just bunk the question because there will be a session on export and import procedure, etc., under which, trust me, these issues will be discussed in very greater detail, and the faculty will be discussing this thing in greater detail. See, there is a question by Mr. Tarun. You see, we are looking at HS6 digit. We are trying to match our product with the importing country's code, because remember, in harmonized system, at HS6 digit level, export and import match. But below HS6 digit, India is following a 10 digit code. India is following an 8 digit code. America is following a 10 digit code. It doesn't match. So you are actually exporting a HS 8 digit product. You can't export a HS 6 digit product. So you will definitely be able to claim government benefit because you are exporting actually a product. All the government is going to do, they're going to see, okay, this is the HS 6 digit, this is the HS 8 digit, fine. Exporting to this country, they will look at their list, okay, there is an export benefit classified, fine, this exporter will get the benefit. So 6 digit, remember, is not the export product. We use the 6 digit when we try to match the trade data with another country. Because you can't match 8-digit India's data with 10-digit of another country. But you are, whatever product you export, you are definitely going to get the export benefit, provided under MEIS the benefit is there. Okay, there is another question from a gentleman. How to search knowing the price of a high-value complex product? Remember here again, we looked at the trade map. In trade map, we looked at the unit price. The unit price is the price of the product. But there is a catch once again. You see, the unit price that we are getting currently from trade map is an average. Those of you who noted the unit price earlier, you must have noted this is given by per kg, per ton, per liter, per square meter. Now, when you are looking at let's say iron bar or a very raw material thing, then this is a perfect measure. But when you are looking at a very high value product, suppose you are looking at a say t-shirt, 100% cotton shirt or so, then some of the time it should be by one unit, right? Or when we are looking at a 3000 cc engine vehicle, when you are looking at the unit price by ton or by kg, it can be slightly misnomer. So some of the time for high value product, when we are looking at the unit price reported by trade map, you have to interpret it with caution. But for intermediate, raw material, etc., the product is perfect. The unit price given here is perfect. So from where you can get it? One option is, some of the time very many agencies like McKinsey, KPMG, they come out with reports on import by other countries. From there you can get it. If you have any membership in a foreign country, like for instance, SIAM is there, Society for Indian Automobile Manufacturers, right? And if you look at the membership of SIAM, Indian players are there, so are the some of the foreign players, foreign automakers who have come to India. The idea is here, we will get SIAM would be able to give their members some of the specific data. So if you get some of this kind of bodies are there abroad and you mail to them, they will be able to give you the correct price. The trademark price some of the time will be aggregative and it will not give you the perfect data. Okay, Mr. Tarun again asking another question. Here, the idea is you are looking at, say in India Trade Portal, what we got. We are looking at 4 or 5 alternate tariff lines from America, which might be matched to your product. For that, remember, as I told earlier, you have to go back to Trademap now. In Trademap, you go for America, go for America's product description for each individual product under HS 6-digit level. Suppose there are 15 products, each description will be given in detail. You look at each one of them carefully and see which one is matching your HS 8-digit product description. You select that. That's the product. Mr. Chittaranjan from Pune, he's also making the point on 630510. So here for the jute products, again, you have to follow the principle that we discussed. In Trademap, first you go for your HS 6-digit code, see which countries are importing the product, identify the market, etc. Then you actually go for the HS 8-digit, see for the tariff barrier from Market Access Map, India Trade Portal, and from there you try to figure out which market is the possible best market for you. Thank you, Mr. Ganesh, for asking the question on anti-dumping duty on tariff rate quota. Both are very important. I will just take a minute and come back to this question. I will answer it by looking at the scenario. Mr. Amulya, you are getting 2 HS codes. In the targeted country, I presume there will be 2 different HS 8 or 10 digit codes. So what we just discussed, please follow it accordingly by going back to Trademap, which one ideally should be there. Mr. Ajay is right. You have identified it correctly. Now, to answer Mr. Ganesh, I will share, just let me share Trademap once again. Sorry, not Trademap, Market Access Map. In Market Access Map, remember, we looked at compare tool earlier, market and competitor. Now suppose we see at Access. In Access, there is something called trade remedies. If we click on the trade remedies, then you actually see anti-dumping, countervailing duty and safeguard measure and any other measure. So what you do, please select this one. Suppose you select anti-dumping, you want to export to, let's say, America. Let's take that example. United States of America. Exporting country obviously would be India. Now you can actually select any year you would like to. Suppose you want to see during the last 5 years whether America imposed anti-dumping duty on your product. So you can actually go year by year and verify that. I will select 2020 only, and suppose I take any one product, say our product only we consider 610910. It's not catching it. Fine, I'll just take one product which it is catching. Let's go for search. So can you see it here? The output is coming. America has imposed. Oh, that's the reason why it was not picking up. It will go by those products from India to America, whether there had been any definitive measure. So please go for what had been the measure. Click on the measure. You can check that against which Indian farms they have imposed ad valorem duty, etc. So all these details you get. And if you click on the document here, we see in the Federal Register in US how they have put up the notice of the anti-dumping duty to be imposed against Indian exporters. So this is about the anti-dumping duty, countervailing duty, etc. I should thank Mr. Ganesh for asking this question. There is one more thing that we can look at. The tariff rate quota he mentioned. For tariff rate quota, what we do, you see there are thousands of international trade databases. I only discussed two of them with you. So suppose we try to think of WTO ITIP, let's say we look at WTO Integrated Trade Intelligence Portal. We click on WTO ITIP. Once we do, we will find there are lot many things. There is a ITIP services, ITIP goods. Let's go to TAO, Tariff Analysis Online. If we go to TAO, you have to register in TAO, just like Trade Map, Market Access Map. I am using it for a long time, so I can just go there. So what you do, just as an example, in Market Access Map, what you did, you can do it here also. Say export duties faced in an export market. If you try to go there, you just select an exporter, say India, select an importer. I'm just selecting Australia here as an example. Any product we are selecting. So I'm just going for my product 6101. I guess internet is a bit slow, it's taking a time to load. It's just, yeah, 90. Just give me a moment, it's still buffering. So this is one problem with all the international databases. Many people use them simultaneously, so it will be slow as a result of that. And let's say you want for the last 15 years, what is the scenario? Click on display here. So you see over the period from 2004, Australia used to impose a 25% tariff on Indian exports. Now it has come down to 5%. So this is one good way in which you can check this. Now, coming back, this column. Yeah, in 5 minutes, we'll see. So, just 1 minute, let me, go to tau. So tariff quota is the question that you asked. We click on tariff quota. We need to select a member. Say Australia we select. So for Australia, all the products it will show for which there is a tariff. We can now from there work out what is the in quota tariff and out quota tariff. So we see the in quota, in quota duties for this product here, 240110.47 per kg, and out of quota final duty is 25, for instance. So what you see, there has been a sharp rise in the out of quota import duty here. So you can check the both duties from here. So we are coming towards the end of the discussion here. Thanks for asking so many good questions. I, for instance, was missing the point of the anti-dumping duty and tariff rate quota. I could just very briefly cover that. Please play with the databases. It will be clear immediately. There is one last question from Mr. Amulya I'm getting for Bangladesh. This is a very pertinent question, but I think you have to really look into the product classification. Offhand, I also can't give you the right answer because you can understand that each HS code will have a unique classification. So I know the principle by which the HS codes go, but each individual HS code, even I will not be able to remember. We have to closely look into the code and then decide. Mr. Madhusudan asked a question, national tariff line and HS numbers, etc. The HS codes essentially, as you can see, up to HS 6 digit, that is unique. That is all countries who are following the World Customs Organization, they are following the code. Now, national tariff line is something at HS 8 or 10 digit level. That's the prerogative of individual country. So India is setting HS 8 digit tariff. America is setting HS 10 digit tariff. Why there is a difference? The difference is coming because whenever a country is producing more, there is a variety. So they have to classify the product with greater precision. In America, when you go for steel, for instance, more classification is coming. But if you go for two-wheeler, you will find in America there is a single classification because America is not producing two-wheelers. They're importing it. If you look at India, Bajaj, TVS, so many good players are there. So you will find in India, there are so many HS 8-digit classifications for two-wheelers are there. Okay, so national tariff line, a country is setting given by their classification. So thank you very much for the session.